and you'll be cooking with us later on.
Yeah, now, just a moment, we'll chat to one of the singer-songwriter Ryan Tedder. But before we do, let's remind ourselves of some of the band's huge hits.
We're joined now by singer-songwriter, producer, and lead singer with One Republic, Ryan Tedder. Now, those three videos between them had over 2 billion watches. Do you have to sort of sometimes pinch yourself?
Yeah, I mean, it's surreal. I think the whole YouTube kind of phenomenon just keeps expounding. At some point, you'll be like, 2 billion, that's nothing. You know, someone's going to have 50 billion and then 100 billion. But yeah, it's been a trip.
Because it says here that you were first, the way you made it was you were sort of discovered on MySpace. What's MySpace?
Well, yeah, I know exactly, right? Yeah, I mean, it was the precursor to Facebook, and we got really lucky. I just saw it as free advertising, and kind of a light bulb went off in my head, and I thought, what, I can kind of spam anybody that I want to, get them to come to shows, show them our music. So we kind of rode MySpace up when it peaked. It had about 250 million people on it. And at that moment, we were the biggest act on that platform.
And how was that translated at the time then to sort of commercial and, if you like, mainstream success?
Yes.
Which happened first?
Well, what happened first, we got signed by Columbia Records. We made an album. We were very much like an alternative rock band. And we got dropped. We played Coachella. We got home. A week later, we got dropped. They dropped us. They dropped Katy Perry. They dropped a handful of acts all the same week.
Wow.
It was a bad week for Columbia. And long story short, I posted the music up on MySpace, let the world kind of decide. Like, I put Apologize, I put Stop and Stare up there, and the songs just took off by themselves completely. Like viral would be the definition, I guess. And before we knew it, every record label was calling us. Because of those songs.
Including wow. Columbia?
Including Columbia, yeah. We got called back by the same label that dropped us. And
The poor guy.
Put this on speaker.
Left hand didn't know what the right hand was doing. So when the guy called me, I said, who do you work for again? He's like, I work for Columbia. I was like, you need to call your boss, ask him about One Republic, see what he says. And that was it. I never really took any more phone calls. We wanted to sign to Universal, and so we did. And the rest is kind of history. We've just been evolving since Apologize and Stop and Stare. Stop and Stare was kind of the song that kept us together because I told the band, if we become the Apologize band and it's a one-hit wonder situation, I'm done. I'm going to fold it. We'll start something new. But then Stop and Stare came out and connected. And then ever since then, you know, our last album had Counting Stars and Love Runs Out and a few others. So it's just kind of been gradual, slow and steady.
So this is the latest album. Here we go. Why is it called that? Oh my.
Well, it's an old phrase, like my grandmother, grandfather used to say that, you know, back when they were in their 80s, when they were still alive. And that phrase, there's a song on the album called Oh My My. And we kind of named it as a joke. We were just tossing around different names. You know, a lot of bands get really... You get self-important and super serious or mysterious, and we wanted it to be lighthearted because we had fun making the album, and so the title is reflective of that. It's kind of an absurd title, but that's us.
We've got a clip here of the second single from the album. It's Kids.
Yeah.
It's So you're a prolific songwriter, so, as well as writing for One Republic. You also you've written for Beyonce, Adele, Taylor Swift, One Direction, Jennifer Lopez, Ellie Goulding, Leona Lewis, Olly Murs, U2, da 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 da. It just goes on and on and on. When you write a song,
yeah.
Can you give it to anyone? Can anyone have any song?
No. I mean, the idea is to marry the right song. It's kind of like a script with an actress. You know, you want to marry the right lyric, the right melody to the right artist. When I'm making a One Republic album, the whole focus becomes us. And so some songs that don't make sense, if they don't make sense for One Republic and I happen to be in the room with Alicia Keys or somebody like that, I might play them a song and say, hey, started this idea, doesn't really work for us, but I think it fits you. And they might take it. So there's a lot of that. Wow. But when I'm doing One Republic, we're focused on us. And then when I'm not doing One Republic, like the moment I wrapped this album, which was in London actually about a month ago, the very next day I was in a session with another artist. And I was, that same week I was finishing a record with Stevie Wonder and Ariana Grande. It actually comes out next week.
Because it's diverse. The people you write for are so incredibly diverse. So
yes.
As a songwriter, when did that happen? Did you get approached to write for other people, or did you say, listen, I've got some kind of great ideas? And
You know, I'm a believer that momentum equals momentum. So once a ball starts rolling, it kind of becomes self-perpetuating, whatever you're doing, right? So the way that it happened, in a quick nutshell, we got dropped as a band. I kind of threw away any. I'd been dropped twice at this point. It's like 2006, I think. 2007. I was like, well, it's just not in the cards for us as a band, but I'm going to start writing and producing. Well, that year, I wrote and produced Bleeding Love. And then I had another record, Love Like Natasha Bedingfield and J-Lo and a few others. I was just doing all kinds of stuff. So Bleeding Love, I find out it's going to be the first single on Leona. It goes to radio in the UK, explodes. That very same month, our song Apologize gets remixed by Timbaland. It explodes. And then both of those combined just kind of created this giant hamster wheel that I've never gotten out of. So it's like, you know, people now will call because they loved Bleeding Love. So I think Beyonce, when she called, she heard a song on her album called Come Home that she loved. I ended up writing Halo for her, which sounds nothing like our song, but she wanted a song for me.
That's
and
it.
And then Adele heard Halo and wanted something like that, which led to Rumor Has It and Turning Tables. So it all becomes this self-perpetuating thing.
Is that the best name-dropping sentence anyone's ever done?
I'm trying to just, like, literally try and pick that up now.
Brilliant.
If you write Halo for Beyonce,
broke your foot.
If you write Halo, would it work for One Direction?
That is a good question. If you have it, vocal range-wise, I mean, it's possible. It's possible, like, you know, the worst mistake you can make, and I've made this before, and I don't want to say which songs they were because it's embarrassing, it just happens. You take a song that's a 10, and you marry, on paper, something seems like a good idea, so you marry it with the artist over here, who's great, and the combination, it's just like too much salt in the soup, and it doesn't work. And you can't predict it, you don't know what's going to happen, but there are a lot of hit records that do not happen. That has nothing to do with the song itself. Bad timing, came out at the wrong time of year. The artist goes into rehab right when they cut it. You know, I mean, I've had everything happen you can imagine. You know, there's some stories I probably could tell you off camera that would blow your mind.
Ooh, Just get the album right now, Tim.
Yeah. Stretch the segment. Stretch it.
Thanks, Ron. Your album, Oh My My, is out now, and you're having tacos with us a little later.
Yes.
That's right, now. After the break.
We released our single on Friends Reunited.
It's called Tacos.
After the break, we're making a spooky pumpkin ticket with Suggs. See you soon. Right, so.